I am the truant officer, madam. And pray, what are your names, my poor children?
My name is Gretel.
And my name is Hans.
Run for your dear little lives. She is a witch and means to eat you for her supper.
Ach, und Himmel!
Ah, your mother rides a vacuum cleaner!
I am Criswell. For years I have told the almost unbelievable, related the unreal, and showed it to be more than a fact. Now I tell a tale of the Threshold people, so astounding that some of you may faint.
This is a story of those in the twilight time, once human, now monsters, in a void between the living and the dead. Monsters to be pitied, monsters to be despised. A night with the ghouls. The ghouls reborn from the innermost depths of the world. Monsters to be pitied. Monsters to be despised. Monsters to be pitied. Monsters to be despised. Monsters to be pitied. Monsters to be despised. Monsters to be pitied. Monsters to be despised.
I'll tell Santa Claus on you.
Hi, and welcome to Ward 13. I hope we can stay on the air. My guest you're my guest today, Matt Connarton.
Hello.
You're not on this side, so you're
yes.
not.
Yes, it's wonderful to be back, although that video you showed had some terrifying moments in it.
The one about the monsters?
Yes, I don't know if you saw, I was sitting over here, I was getting ready to get under the table, I was very afraid.
Well, you know, it's an incredible thing that's going on in Manchester. I know that you mostly spent your adult years in Concord, is that true?
That is true, yes.
That, you know, when Mayor Gatsas presented his budget for fiscal year 2017, the Board of Aldermen gave him a standing ovation, including 11 Democrats.
Really?
Out of 14. Now, some of those Democrats were reluctant.
Yeah.
I think it was Keith Hirschman, who's a Republican, who had told me during the primary that he was actually for Patrick Arnold.
Okay.
So he doesn't talk to me anymore, so
what the hell. I
knew he really wasn't.
But they gave him a stand, you know, they actually got up and applauded?
Oh, yeah, and the union leader made a thing of it. And that scary monster, the minister of propaganda of Gatsasland, Rich Gerard.
Yes.
When Gatsas went on the Rich Gerard show, the radio show, he indeed brought up the standing ovation. But what's amazing, and a lot of Democrats are talking about, is that the Board of Aldermen are giving Gatsas a free ride. Mm. Just a free ride. The meeting yesterday lasted 1 hour. 1 hour. That's, you know, I only started following the board around summer of 2013.
Sure.
So it's very unusual. And the chairman of the board used to be Danny O'Neill, who there was no love lost between Danny and Gatsas.
Do you think they want him to look good on his way to the governor's race so he gets out of here and goes to Concord?
Well, that's funny because I texted one of the aldermen and said, when is the board officially going to endorse Ted Gatsas for governor?
Yeah.
It's a love fest.
Yeah.
And, you know, some of the Democrats are wondering, you know, what's going on?
Yeah.
And why would anyone? We have a guest coming up a little later in the show. He is Thomas Massengale, who has sworn. We had to sign an oath with the Minister of Propaganda of mm-hmm. Gatsasland that no F-bombing, and we did go over a few of the words that he can't say.
Yes, yes.
Now, Tom promised to be a good boy today. He's actually doing what we said and not coming in.
He is. That's amazing. Wow. He learns quick.
I think we have a defective camera over here.
Oh, my goodness.
But the thing is about Gatsas, it's just kind of remarkable. It's like, what happened to democracy? Remember, like last year, I used to have the Photoshop things, although I don't own Photoshop. I use something much worse, of him as El Duce, you know, Mussolini, a dictator.
Yeah.
And now it's just, he gets up there and he gets what he wants.
That's amazing. And he's ambitious, certainly, I mean, to try to want to take on the Sununu machine to win the Republican nomination for governor? I don't think he has much of a chance, personally.
Well, there was a, on Carol Rubido's site, Manchester Inkling, they gave out there was a list of 46 of his campaign people, the finance committee.
Yeah.
And, you know, Dick Arnengast?
Anagnost.
Anagnost. Yes. I have dyslexia, just slight.
Oh, okay.
It's enough to screw everything up. And, you know, certain big, big wheels, Andy Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the people was on the board, testified in front of the board last night about this unique insurance program that indeed he brought before the city, and the city of Manchester, you know, implemented it.
Sure.
And there he was. He was on the list of Gatsas's people. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
They're fighting. I think he's the same. There's another person that was on the list. We can do something about, you know, I'll look it up here. Was the guy who Gatsas gave Hackett Hill. You know where Hackett Hill
is? Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was this big piece of property. It's the last really remaining piece of property where you could have, like, light industrial.
Okay.
Since the Board of Aldermen seemed to be giving away everything, including the old Sylvania.
Sure.
So, you know, BAE is expanding in Londonderry and Derry, yet no jobs here in Manchester mm-hmm. for BAE.
Yeah.
And so this developer, Gatsas negotiated giving him Hackett Hill for, you know, for a price.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to build a fire station up there with his own money. And it was supposed to be light industrial, try to get corporate headquarters up from Boston and everything.
Yeah.
Well, guess what? Within a year, those plans were through. It came, you know, like a commercial, residential, which is not exactly the same for the tax base.
Right.
There was no station, no police station, a fire station built. And, you know, you fast forward a few years, and now some other developer is trying to go ahead and do it, you know?
Mm.
But they're going to do apartment complexes, residential.
Yeah.
That's okay, John. And it's just strange what goes on in the city. You know, these people that are on his... Oh, here we go.
Oh.
I have no home. Hunted. Despised. Living like an animal. The jungle is my home. That I will show the world that I can be its master. I will perfect my own race of people. A race of atomic supermen which will conquer the world.
Well, good morning, lovey. Anything important?
Just that letter from Mr. Graham. It can wait. Have your juice and coffee first.
There's an old spinning wheel where my head is. Can't remember last night, what a crime. But I'm feeling so rotten this morning. Must have had me a wonderful time.
Ah, it's nothing like fresh orange juice.
Out near my next guest is by far one of the most talented guys in show business. He acts, he sings, but most of all, he does the greatest impression that you have ever seen. Well, I don't have to tell you. You can see for yourself. The Riddler himself, Mr. Frank Gorshin.
Thanks so much. I play the Riddler on Batman. Of course, as you know, every week on Batman, there's a different guest villain. Well, while working on the show, I thought, what would it be like if every week there were a different Batman and a different Robin? One week you might see Burt Lancaster playing Batman and Kirk Douglas playing Robin. It would go like this.
Robin, old chum? Once again, it's time to come to the aid of Gotham City and rid its streets of crime and corruption. Correct?
Correct.
Correct. This time we have in our hands that slippery devil, Mr. Sweat.
Mr. Sweat? Holy perspiration. That him again? Hey, gosh, Batman, I wonder what he's up to this time.
No need to wonder, boy. Wonder, so wonder, wonder, boy. I got the whole thing figured out. To the bat poles. I like going down the bat pole, Boy Wonder.
Yeah, me too, Cape Crusader. Oh, golly gee whiz. I forgot to tell you, when Alfred was cleaning up today, he accidentally spilt a bucket of glue on one of the bat poles.
No kidding, Robin. I wonder which one it was. Robin?
The following week, you might see Rod Steiger playing the Boy Wonder, and Brando playing Batman.
Batman! Batman!
What are you getting so excited about, Robert? I'm standing right here. I'm standing right here, right next to you. Good heavens, great Scott, and good gravy. Well, I don't know about you, Robin. Robbie.
What? Now, I have heard through the bat vine that you are going to give me away. You hear that? You are going to give me away, me, your faithful ward. Now, without me, you are nothing. You hear that? You give me away, I promise you, the bat phone, the bat arang, the batmobile, the bat can, everything bat goes. Holy bat rupsy!
Robbie, you just don't understand. Remember when I was talking to Commissioner Gordon on the phone, I said, hello, Commissioner. Commissioner, I promise you that within 24 hours, we will deliver your villain. I give you my word. I didn't say I give you my ward. Robbie.
Best impressions I've ever seen, and that last impression of Sinatra was perfect. That was beautiful. Listen, I got a riddle. Next time you see Batman, you want to lay it on him?
All right.
Now, what's got 1,000 feet and only one head?
I don't know. What's got 1,000 feet and only one head?
500 guys sharing a can of beer.
Can I go now?
Oh, yeah.
No, no.
Yeah.
I got a couple of riddles you may not have heard.
All right, what are they?
Riddle me this. What do you call a sleeping bull?
All right. What do you call a sleeping bull?
Answer. A bulldozer.
Oh! Oh, baby, come on.
Let me take you where the action is.
Oh, baby, come on. So neat to meet your baby where the action is. In every little town across the USA, there's a spot where the people tangle every day. Just leave your problems and get away. Come on down and listen to the guitar play. Woo! Dance, dance, dance when you hear that beat.
Well, my God, we're back on the air.
It seems like we got interrupted there by the Ministry of Propaganda, I think.
Well, I signed my pledge.
Yes.
Here it is, folks. And we're going to be gentlemen today. No F-bombing, although I did F-bomb just a little while back.
Well, that doesn't count.
Right.
It was off the air.
Sometimes I think that, you know, people... My 14 viewers turn in just to see if I am going to explode.
Yes.
Not today. In fact, we have a guest with us today. David Colapinto of the National Whistleblower Center is here, and we're going to talk about the Panama Papers.
Mm.
And we're not talking about marijuana, Matt, and 420.
Okay.
Well, they used to have Panama Red. I don't know, you know,
oh,
what
I,
they have nowadays.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that was a Panama Red. It was a strain of marijuana.
Tom, can you help me here? Tom Massengale?
What do you need to know about Panama Red?
I get the idea. I thought we were going to talk about Panama by Van Halen. Eddie's solo in that. So I'm all confused.
John, are we going to be able to cut to the Skype when they talk? Hey, Dave, tell us about the Panama Papers. Your law firm was involved, I think, it was in the UBS tax evasion scandal.
Right. That was the case of Bradley Birkenfeld, who ended up going to jail, but also got a $104 million award from the IRS as a result of turning in the names of people who had secret bank accounts and were engaged in tax evasion at UBS in Switzerland. Those were American citizens.
Okay.
This particular scandal really is, you know, it's another piece of offshore tax evasion by wealthy individuals, and some pretty high-profile people around the world have been snagged in this scandal.
The Prime Minister of Iceland just resigned.
Yes.
That's right. That's right. He had a secret offshore company, was hiding millions of dollars that hadn't been declared previously. And this is a huge story in the international press. 11.5 million pages of documents, 2.6 terabytes of data.
That's incredible.
It's not a traditional whistleblower leak. The press reports indicate that it was procured as the result of a hack, at least according to this law firm down in Panama that got, that is, you know, where all these papers come from.
Well, let's ask you about that law firm. What is Mossack Fonseca and Company? I have here, I got it from the BBC. I understand that British Prime Minister David Cameron is under suspicion too, although he's denying it. The Mossack Fonseca Group is a leading international corporation which provides comprehensive legal, trust, technological, and accounting services. Now, this is based in Panama, right?
That's right. That's right. And their specialty and their role in this would be to set up private offshore companies or trusts. So it would provide the vehicle for people to hide money from tax authorities.
So really,
so the setting up of the trusts and the companies themselves is not legal. It is not illegal.
Yeah.
However, you know, what did they know? In some cases, they were complaining in some of the email correspondence that I read after the UBS scandal. UBS was trying to blame this law firm, and they were all blaming each other. And the law firm was complaining they didn't even know the names of the people who on whose behalf they were setting up these entities. So
Dave,
this took on a long time.
Dave, I see that Credit Suisse is involved in this, and they were, after UBS, they got busted for helping tax evasion by not only Americans, but Germans, French, Europeans.
That's right. That's right. And they pled guilty under U.S. law and have paid a huge fine.
So really, I mean, it sounds to me like they're in the business of secrecy, right? I mean, you know, if you want to hide money, hide assets, whether, and I would assume, I mean, what Mossack Fonseca does there's nothing illegal about it, but I would imagine that some people, obviously, if they're trying to hide money, what they're doing, what the individuals who are hiding that money is doing in some cases is illegal if they're trying to evade taxes.
Well, setting up an offshore company isn't illegal per se, mm-hmm. but if you know that your client is using it for a purpose, for example, these people are being referred by banks that could no longer hide assets in Switzerland. So after the UBS scandal and Credit Suisse scandal broke, these people had to go somewhere if they didn't want to turn themselves into U.S. and other countries' tax authorities.
So okay.
This money had to go somewhere. There's illegal money out there that is always going to be out there.
Yeah.
And this is a place where it landed. And, you know, there's a lot of different locations around the world where illegal offshore banking occurs.
Dave, Iceland, the now former Prime Minister of Iceland, organized a offshore company with, I think, over $11 million and put the shares in his wife's name. And he never declared it to the Parliament of Iceland. Of course, he's claiming he did no wrong.
Right.
Is that how high-scale tax evasion, April 15th's coming up. I'm sure the people I know are going to be cheating, you know. A little, like, you know, we go and pretend that we go get receipts for giving goodwill and that.
Right, right.
Although goodwill, you actually do have to give them something.
Yeah, true. And, yeah.
That you probably overstate that. Is this how wealthy people cheat on their taxes? They're
yes.
abetted by, what are these called, private banks?
And what they do is they set up these offshore companies to hide assets and transfer assets. They're really shell companies because they don't do anything except store, secret money. And it's a good way to try to evade detection. If you're not going to declare money on your taxes and you claim that this money is an offshore entity, what's the reach of the U.S. government or the German government or the U.K. to get at this, to get at these companies if they're formed offshore?
Well, tax treaties.
Well, right? Yes, but you have to know they exist. And if these funds are being funneled through banks in countries where they are receptive to hiding money, then that those areas of the world are shrinking, but there still are places where it can be done.
So when, after the Bradley Birkenfeld revelations, the United States was able to get a better tax treaty with Switzerland, but didn't the illegal activity move to Luxembourg other countries?
Yeah, that's right. It moved to other countries, and they're hiding assets in these strange instruments.
What's a strange instrument? That sounds right up Ward 13's alley. You know, we used to have the program Amsterdam, which claimed it was television at its worst.
Yes,
I'm going for that crown now.
You got to understand, some of these companies and trusts are so complicated, you wouldn't know who the owners are.
Okay.
Even if you were to subpoena the company.
Okay.
Isn't it true that when they somebody goes, let's say. If somebody from, I don't know, IRS, Treasury Department of Justice, something, would go down and try to find this company, all they would basically find is a bunch of post office boxes, and those are indeed the companies.
Yeah. Right. It's a paper shell company.
Yeah.
That was the Cayman Islands.
And that's what's happening here. And then they're finding a place. You can set up a shell company, but where are the assets of that company hidden? They could be in a bank account in Hong Kong or some other country around the world.
With this, though, it's interesting. I haven't seen any American names, at least not yet. I mean, obviously, there's a lot to go through, but it seems like it's all international players in this so far.
Well, the big names that they've released so far are international. I read a news report yesterday where the McClatchy newspaper chain said there was 3,000 U.S. Passports, copies of them in the files.
Oh, okay.
So, and they said a lot of those people were retirees, but there are some names are starting to leak out. There are some former tax evaders that have already been exposed in other scandals that are on the list. And we'll see. We'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah.
You know, Dave, look, pardon me, a BBC has the number of shell companies registered with Mossack Fonseca, the legal firm that helped the tax evaders, because we assume everybody's doing this for the evasion of taxes. And it turns out Credit Suisse, through a Channel Islands subsidiary, had almost 900 shell companies that it was servicing through Mossack Fonseca. HSBC has about 1,500, with one in Monaco and one in Switzerland.
Yeah.
And UBS has about 600. But it's I think it's a German subsidiary. The amazing thing that strikes me is that Credit Suisse, HSBC, and UBS are all at the center of the scandals going on, the tax evasion scandals in the European Union and the United States ever since Mr. Birkenfeld did blow the whistle on
UBS. Well, that's right. And their clients who didn't want to comply, who wanted to continue the money laundering for whatever reason. There's lots of reasons beyond just not paying taxes that people launder money.
So you're talking about when the IRS, in the wake of the Birkenfeld's UBS scandal, allowed the tax cheats an amnesty, right? U.S.
Well, that's right, and that, but those are for U.S. citizens. But that's just a piece of the Swiss banking business. We're U.S. citizens. There were people from all over the world with deposits who weren't reporting, who were hiding their assets in Swiss banks. And the Birkenfeld case only brought in the names of U.S. citizens. So slowly, some of these other countries have stepped up to the plate and have demanded accountability. And basically, the Swiss banking business has been slowly broken. And seeing that happen, these people knew that they couldn't keep their money in Switzerland much longer. They had to find other places and other vehicles to move the money. And that's what you're seeing in this piece of the scandal.
What else does this company do? Because
wait, let's step back a minute.
Because I understand
some Swiss money went over to Panama. But, I mean, these guys have been in business, what, 40 years doing this?
Yeah.
Right.
And there are tax havens all around the planet.
That's correct.
That we're not, I mean, the interesting thing here is that there are English possessions who the United Kingdom could easily throttle down and take control of.
You mean the Channel Islands?
While pretending they want to get rid of tax havens and these problems.
That's correct.
We're also one of the main people, one of the main countries enabling it.
Well, that's right. And, you know, I was surprised to read, I don't know if this is true, Tom, maybe you know, that the, reading about the Cameron Family Trust that popped up in these papers, that in the UK, the candidates for prime minister or for parliament aren't required to release their, or aren't, traditionally don't release their tax returns.
Correct.
So, I mean, there's a lot of ramifications here. I mean, slowly, emphasize slowly, the secret bank account business is being chipped away. But you're right, it's happening in a lot of places, and it's being facilitated by people who are wealthy who want to continue the money laundering.
Here's a quotation from Prime Minister David Cameron, a Tory, a Conservative Party leader, who won an outright majority in the last election, responding to the criticism of Labour Party leader Jeremy Corbyn, the leader of the loyal opposition. It sounds a little like the Prime Minister of Iceland. In terms of my own financial affairs, I own no shares of this trust that his father created that is an offshore company.
He said not only does he not have any shares, he also doesn't have any offshore assets.
Right, because like the Prime Minister of Iceland, it's probably in his wife's name or somebody else.
Well, we don't know. We know that his father did set up such a shell.
You know, it's
that's, to be fair to him, that's all we know at this point. But these things have a way of being revealed. So,
right. Yeah. You know, Dave, it's interesting. One of the people that Bradley Birkenfeld revealed was it Oleg Alenikov?
Yeah.
Who was a Russian, but American. He was born in the Soviet Union. Was he a developer, a real estate developer? Who was a billionaire and evaded taxes. And he just got like a slap on the wrist for, you know, hiding all these assets. And he'd been dodging taxes for like decades. And the IRS had been after him. Now they have something, and you can look it up in Wikipedia, the Alenikov defense. Ty Warner is a billionaire. He made his billions from Beanie Babies. They caught him, you know, at least, you know, hiding billions offshore.
Wow.
Even though he didn't have to, or it might not even have been billions.
Yeah.
He was just hiding this money offshore. And they gave him a wrist slap because he used the Alenikov defense.
Okay.
And I think he had to cough up between 50 or 80 million, but he had, you know, a significant tax savings from hiding the money. The speculation was those Beanie Babies were manufactured in China. And they created a UBS, I think it was, helped them create an offshore corporation. And the money from the Beanie Babies went from China into that offshore account. So nobody really knows the amount of money Ty Warner actually is worth or he had.
Right.
Why is the IRS and the Department of Justice so lenient with these American tax cheats? Is it just a case, well, we'll get what we can?
Well, yeah, they've tended to protect the people and given them light treatment. They're trying to, one way they justify it is saying we're trying to encourage people to voluntarily comply and repatriate the money on their own. So if you come in voluntarily, we won't, you know, hit you very hard. But the people that you're talking about, they were not cooperative. These are people that, you know, people who have been caught red-handed
indicted
and didn't voluntarily pay the tax are getting less, you know, very, very little punishment, not jail time. And, you know, the guy that exposed the whole scandal to begin with, Brad Birkenfeld, ended up, they threw the book at him and he spent time in jail.
What did he do? Over 3 years, didn't he?
He did about 3 years, yeah.
Wow.
3 years.
For 30 months, something like that.
Now, if you look in the French press, and my French is pretty bad, they call things like the L'Affaire Birkenfeld, and there's like post-Birkenfeld, pre-Birkenfeld, and post-Birkenfeld. Now, France is being very aggressive going after its tax cheats, is it not?
Yeah, it is. It is, and it's very much the rage right now in France. They have a full-scale investigation into UBS and other Swiss banks. And, the secret bank accounts in Switzerland has been the source of a lot of bad money for years. The fact that it's being revealed is starting to break the back of it. Mm. But, you know, there's a long way to go. And you know, people need to, I mean, how much money is still being hidden out there? There's a lot of money laundering going on. What, you know, who are the people who launder money?
Well, you don't really think about David Cameron laundering money, but I might be naive.
Putin showing up wasn't such a surprise. And what else does this Mossack and Fonseca do? There's something here about they provide maritime services, like registering yachts and vessels. And
that sounds like a legitimate business too, doesn't it?
Yeah, Panama is one of those countries like Liberia that you flag a ship.
Yeah.
For whatever reasons, lax. But Panama's always been that way. But what surprises me is that I remember in the 1990s, the United States and Canada were getting very successful in trying to get the Cayman Islands and the Bahamas to, for transparency, to obey the Bank of, it was called the Bank of International Settlements, the BIS in Switzerland, which kind of sets rules about accounting, transparency. They came very close to using muscle to get compliance in what I could, you know, the offshore industry, Cayman Islands, Bahamas. And then George W. Bush was elected president, and one of the first things he did on his actual first day was end that.
Oh, really?
But still, I never associate Panama with this offshore industry. Why Panama? Does it have something to do with Bush and the Obama administration? Why didn't the Bush and the Obama administrations seek a tax treaty with Panama?
That I don't know the answer to.
You're not a clairvoyant,
not
huh?
On the Panamanian financial system. I know that a lot of large banks from around the world are located there. There's a lot of Japanese banks there, for example. It has been a money laundering center for years.
Well, we retook Panama. You know, we conquered it because of the drug trade, and now suddenly it's as corrupt as it ever was. I mean, about Panama, you're talking about virtually like a U.S. protectorate.
Right.
I might be not, you know, I'm thinking, I haven't really thought about Panama in years.
Well, you've got to think of the influence of the drug cartels and other interests in the world. Money. It's going to be drugs and guns and, you know, all types of shady things, you know, that are going on. And maybe there are, you know, U.S. interests involved there as well in terms of...
You mean CIA?
Yeah.
Because UBS, one of its first scandals in the modern era, I think it predates the Holocaust assets. Because you got the Swiss banks just held on to the assets of Holocaust victims and even survivors, you know?
Yeah.
Just You're not getting it until the U.S., I think. That was a whistleblower that blew the whistle on the Holocaust assets back in the 90s.
That's right.
But
that's
in the 80s, they were involved in accusations of money laundering for the cartels, like out of Colombia, and even the old mafia in Europe, you know, like the French connection.
Wait a minute.
What?
I mean, I think we're making a mistake going too much into talking about drug cartels when talking about this money laundering problem. I mean, yes, drug money is very significant. But, you know, in 2011, when the Panama Free Trade Agreement was signed with the United States, Sanders warned on the Congress floor
Sanders
that would lead to exactly this kind of scandal.
You mean Bernie Sanders?
But Tom, this predates.
Wait, hear me out, though. Because I want to hear what you have to say, because I'm fairly ignorant about this. What he said was, Panama is a world leader when it comes to allowing wealthy Americans and large corporations to evade U.S. taxes by stashing their cash in offshore tax havens. And the Panama Free Trade Agreement would make this bad situation much worse. Now, I don't, and John probably doesn't understand why that free trade agreement would make the situation much worse.
I don't understand.
I don't either. Right. I mean, I don't think any of us do. But the, you know, money laundering in Panama is not something that just started after 2011. This is something that's...
Oh, no, no. He said this would make a bad situation much worse.
Yeah, okay. That's a generalization like a lot of things Bernie says. I mean, it's great, but, you know, I agree with him on that. It probably is. He's probably right, but I don't know what he's talking about in terms of the details.
Right, hey, right. You don't know about the free trade agreement with Panama.
I don't.
That was pushed by Obama and his Secretary of State at the time, Hillary Clinton.
Okay.
We don't know. Now this was not a leak, correct? This was a hack.
That's what they're saying in the press reports, is that it was a hack, which is an interesting angle to this story, because it is not an insider that we know of. I mean, but who knows? Maybe it was a combination of an inside whistleblower with a hacker, or was it just a hacker, targeting this particular law firm, knowing that that's where secrets were?
Mm-hmm.
Now, there was a French whistleblower, or maybe Swiss, Hervé, I can't remember his name, and the Swiss went after him. For all, you know, he leaked a bunch of documents, I think Credit Suisse.
Right.
And it was a tremendous trove. And I think he actually got remuneration from a German or a French newspaper. But the Swiss hit him with all sorts of laws, like violating intellectual property. There's all sorts of ways you can go after a whistleblower in Europe, isn't there? The United States.
Well, that's right, and they tried him in absentia. He didn't show up for his trial. They held the trial, and they convicted him anyway. And so, you know, that's...
He can't go back to Switzerland.
In Switzerland, it's illegal to blow the whistle on the banking industry.
And they would go...
committing crimes.
And they would go after the documents as, like, property, would they not?
Well, that's right. It's an illegal act to make any disclosure, and he clearly made a disclosure. But the amount of documents you're talking about in the Credit Suisse case pales in comparison to what we're talking about here, in terms of it wasn't anywhere close to a terabyte of data.
Herve Valciani. You think after watching
these... That's his name.
Yeah, Valciani. Yeah.
That's this is the largest leak or document dump in history, right?
That's what they're saying. Absolutely. Yeah.
Now,
it's remarkable.
And nobody knows who's behind it.
Nobody yet has been revealed. And that's going to be an interesting thing. What's going to happen to if the identity of a hacker ring is revealed? Will they go after those people?
My God, look at The Guardian, which is one of the great newspapers. Although, you know, I'm always harassing Gabriel Goodliffe and Tom when they mention The Guardian. And once again, the World Soccer Organization, what's it called? The football?
FIFA
is involved in this. This is an organization that's famous for bribing, you know, half the world.
Well, we don't know exactly. It was probably, it may have very well been the leaders of FIFA who are now on their way out of office for other scandals.
That's right. I think you're right, Tom.
My God, they have Stanley Kubrick is part of this? Yeah. The great film director?
Wow.
Dave, I'm also curious. I don't know if you read Glenn Greenwald.
Occasionally I do.
But his take on this was that what was really going to be interesting is not the dump of what's happened that's illegal, but the shock of what has actually been legalized in terms of tax avoidance globally.
That's an excellent point.
Yeah, it is excellent. It's a good point. And it's, you know, why are they getting such advantages? That's a valid question.
Right.
What can we do to stop? Can you stop tax evasion by rich people, rich, well-connected people?
But not as long as they're writing the laws, you can't.
Right, right. Yeah,
well,
good point.
And also, I think what's interesting about this leak is, you know, it's shining a big, bright light in areas where they don't want it to be shined. So, you know, yeah, I don't know. I mean, you've got to, you know, if you shine the light on Panama, on this law firm, are they going to find another place?
My God, look at all the people.
There are loads of places. I mean,
yeah, exactly. So, you know, you can contain it here, but it's going to pop up somewhere else.
Right. What? Oh, there are already big banks ready to take your money.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm sure they are.
Hey, Dave, how are the Washington Nationals doing?
They're 1-0.
We're 5 minutes early on that. Well, I have a question for Dave. Dave will know something about this. Obama got a lot of credit for being the one to push the Swiss hard to get the information out of them. But at least, yeah, as a member of the general public, I'm not seeing a general effort.
That's not
to
what
back down.
They weren't pushed hard.
Who wasn't pushed hard? I was looking at this trove of information.
The Swiss weren't pushed hard by Obama to reveal that. I mean, it was a long-standing... When Brad Birkenfeld came forward to blow the lid on UBS, the U.S. government had, you know, they couldn't make a case. There had been nobody who had come forward. They needed an insider to come forward. And that's what broke the backs of the Swiss. And in fact, the deals that were made by the Obama administration were actually quite lenient on the Swiss, considering what was going on. They didn't require all of the names to be given over, for example. Why is it that they gave them sort of a sweetheart deal, which a lot of people complained about at the time it happened?
I mean, I believe you're absolutely right. And at the same time, there was a different narrative that was spun in the media.
Because it was a first...
came from the White House.
Well, the narrative was it's the first time we're getting our foot in the door into the Swiss banks. So it was justified on that basis. But in hindsight, it is a, you know, it was weak. It was, you know, why are you only requiring 4,000 names when you know there are thousands more?
You know, Tom, I was just reading, it's very light reading, but it interests me, Ian Fleming, the actual James Bond novels, because Ian Fleming actually was a commander, you know, 05, just beneath a captain in the Naval Reserve, and was an MI6, which they call the British Secret Service. He was an MI6 agent, and once you're an MI6, it's like CIA, you always are.
Yeah.
It's always interesting to read his stuff because of the tidbits of knowledge about spycraft, because he always has, you know, what's going on, like in 56, I just read From Russia with Love. And one of the things they're talking about, I think it was Blofeld, you know, who they resurrected for this disappointing James Bond movie.
Yeah.
Talking about how the Swiss, because Blofeld in, on Her Majesty's Secret Service, is in Switzerland after some caper he did. And Bond has to go there. And they talk about how the Swiss will do nothing to help the British, to help the United States, that they'll actually protect even known criminals because they don't want anything to interfere with the Swiss franc, any ripple. And the Swiss, you know, Holocaust assets is just one of the many things that the Swiss have dealt with.
Huh.
You know, they've laundered money for years.
Yeah.
And they... happened, the Birkenfeld case, that was unprecedented, was it not, Dave?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's like
to back the Swiss
banking secrecy was the gold standard. How their economy operated.
Right. There's really they don't really have much. It's a beautiful country, and they're skiing, but they're. You know, Calvin Coolidge said the business of America is business, but in Switzerland, it's banking. International banking.
Right, but see, in America, a big part of the business is war.
Where yes.
The Swiss,
it's our greatest export.
You take sides in a war, you lose a lot of clients.
Well, yeah. You can always snatch their assets, right?
Right.
difficult for a little country like Switzerland to have far-reaching effects with snatching of assets. But when you stay neutral... Everybody trusts you, and everybody does business with you.
Well, they were a middleman with many
people.
So
it's a criminal to you or I is a client to UBS.
Well, yeah. In Switzerland, tax evasion is not a crime, is it, Dave?
It's all about bank secrecy.
Yeah.
And banking secrecy was sacrosanct. It'd be like beyond the Second Amendment to certain Americans, beyond the First Amendment. It is the great reason for Switzerland to exist. Remember, Switzerland is a federation of cantons. It's a federal system. They, you know, it's the canton, what is it, Helvetia? It's the Helvetian Republic. There really isn't a Switzerland so much as it's these individual cantons, and they're very fierce about protecting their own business inside the cantons. We're talking about the big international banks, but they're also what they're called canton, you know, canton banks, like state banks. And they're quite corrupt themselves. They just don't have the reach. And I think UBS and Credit Suisse and HSBC have, which is a British banking company. It's the old Hong Kong, what was it? Shanghai Banking Corporation. But it has a major operation in Switzerland.
Oh, really?
You know, but they would use the Cantonese would sound like China.
Yeah.
Canton banks, regional banks to help in their subterfuges. So
I was just looking actually how the different countries are reacting, and I guess China, you mentioned China. Apparently, it's just a kind of a blackout there. They're just ignoring it, saying these have groundless accusations, and we're not even going to acknowledge it. But that's China.
When you're a manufacturer like Donald Trump, and we have Trumpy Cat up here, I hope you guys can see.
Oh yeah, we can see it.
When you have the Chinese can put money in Panama, Monaco, Luxembourg, wherever you want your money to be. Mm-hmm. It's never physically there.
Right.
Well, reportedly, the brother-in-law of the president of China was a client of this firm as well.
Oh, okay.
Geez, they have so much capital. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Are you suggesting that Trumpy Cat had a few shekels down in Panama?
Probably. I know that when you get to the UBS case, there were over 19,000 people that I think Brad Birkenfeld revealed. How many, Dave, did they actually release the information about? About 4,500?
4,500, but a lot of people from UBS who were depositors, American depositors from UBS and other Swiss banks, came in voluntarily in the amnesty program. So a lot more money was repatriated than just the 4,500 depositors' money.
But that means 14,500 or 15,000 Americans that were tax cheats got away with it, didn't they?
Well, they all got away with it in terms of not doing any jail time. You know, most of them... I would say probably most of them came in voluntarily to pay their tax, so they wouldn't be
Voluntarily. What does that mean?
Well, it's coercive voluntariness, but it's, you know, a lot of those people have since paid their taxes and fines.
Not in the company of a federal marshal.
What's that?
Not in the company of a federal marshal when they came to pay.
No, they had a lawyer.
Voluntarily means, John.
Yeah, exactly.
So you have any predictions about baseball?
Wait, Dave. I have a question. Did I hear correctly that you were Bradley's counsel?
Yes.
Fantastic, Dave. Ward 13 has done it again.
What's that? Lowered the standards of Manchester Community College?
No, you of all people have actually raised the standards.
Oh.
Well, we'll have to heavily edit this then so it can be used to further the public good. I don't think you want any hula hooping. Baseball. Dave, you missed our last show.
I did. I'm very sorry about that.
You're a dual fan, Red Sox and the Washington Nationals. What can you tell us about? We know the Red Sox are going to win the division, although I guess that John Farrell's days are numbered. Dombrowski, is that his name?
Yeah.
The new GM from who is with Baltimore, wants to unceremoniously expletive delete can him as soon as possible.
You can't fire him if the team is winning.
Right.
That's true. Did Steinbrenner ever fire somebody with a winning Yankees team?
Oh, I'm sure he did, yeah. Weren't they winning when Billy got into that fight?
Oh, that's right. They were winning.
Yeah.
Jeez, wouldn't they be playing Dallas Green or somebody? Dave, how are the Nats going to do?
I think they're going to do very well.
Playoffs?
The pressure's off this year. No one's talking about World Series or bust. Everybody's talking about the Mets. And meanwhile, they've recovered from some of their injuries. They've got Bryce Harper. We'll see how Steven Strasburg does today. Max Scherzer looked good the other day. They've rebuilt their bullpen.
How's the managing?
Well, they got Dusty Baker, who actually has been, you know, don't laugh, he has been a breath of fresh air in Washington after the Matt Williams disaster.
For sure.
He's a player's manager. The team is very loose. So I like what I'm seeing so far. They had a great record in spring training. That doesn't mean much, but it certainly means something with this team to give them a boost of confidence.
I agree. I really have no idea.
Matt, you don't even know how many innings there are in baseball.
Yeah, it's like 11, aren't there?
I think the federal marshals are starting to come for us. But
uh-oh.
Do you have anybody on your show today?
No, I was going to invite you to stick around if you'd like. But
Well, the meter maid might get me. So maybe a half hour.
Invite you to stick around.
Hey, what about the Yankees? They're a bunch of losers, Tom.
Right, but in 2 years, we're going to have Bryce Harper, so it'll work out okay.
At what, $35 million a year?
No, he wants $400 million.
Yeah.
For how many years? 10?
Who knows? Whatever he wants, you know.
It's nice work if you can get it.
He's Bryce Harper.
Isn't there a salary cap, this, that, or the other thing?
What?
What do you have? Don't you have to pay a tax?
Is there a salary cap? No, sir, there isn't.
No, there's a luxury tax.
Threshold.
A luxury tax which teams would be willing to pay in order to pay a mega contract to... I think the Nats were actually seriously talking about paying him $40 million a year in the offseason.
Right.
How much a year?
$40
million. Jeez, I bet he's going to get the offshore tax. Right.
I mean, he's a guy like Winfield. He's young enough. He's athletic enough. A 10-year contract would pay off.
Oh, come on. Look at the Yankees. You're crippled with these 10-year contracts.
Your money's worth out of Bryce Harper. And remember, I mean, we've been living in a time of apparent no-flation. But that's going to change again, and there will come a time where his deal looks
cheap. Uh-oh, I hear... Keep going, Matt. I hear somebody knocking.
I'm sure you'll be able to follow the action. As for the cast, the critics agree Anne Margaret gives a performance of shattering impact.
Oh,
don't have very much to offer.
You're putting me on.